The following is paid program by the Seniors Rock Show. The content of this show is that of the Seniors Rock Show and does not reflect the views or policies of this station or iHeartMedia.
Welcome to the Seniors Rock Show, presented by the Law Office of Michael Robinson, PC, on News Radio, Wham 1180. The Seniors Rock Show, a lively weekly discussion, shedding a bright light on aging with fun, entertainment, and important info for all adults. Join in with your comments or questions. Call or text 222-1180 or 1-800-295-1180. Now from the News Radio Wham 1180 studio in downtown Rochester.
And elder law attorney Michael Robinson is on vacation today. Or I guess I should tell you, he's out touring. And if you're a regular listener, you know that Mike is a Grateful Dead fan. And he is very dedicated. And yes, Mike is out following the Grateful Dead band for a few days, just like he probably did in his youth. So I wanted to say, hey, Mike, and I think that this Grateful Dead thing is a fan thing, and I'm sure there's a lot of people out there with you, so I hope you're having fun, you senior rocker, you. I've got plenty of company today, though, so don't worry about me. I'll be joined by guests, Rochester City Councilman for the Northwest District, Jose Pio. Also, Chris Gauvin of Blossom Modern Home Care Solutions and Genesee Valley physical therapist Sarah LIPINSKI. And she's going to talk about physical therapy issues common in older women. So let's get going. I heard my first guest on Wham on the Bob Lonsbury Show not long ago. And I was drawn to his very positive attitude. And I thought to myself, this guy makes sense. And I don't usually think that when I'm listening to some people speaking. So I thought we'd be lucky to have his voice in the midst of some of the chaos and some of the things that we're experiencing here in our fair city of Rochester. Then I saw his dog walk talks when I did a little research online. And I definitely had to invite him to the show. So I'm happy now to introduce Jose Pio. Jose is Rochester-born and raised. He's a U.S. Army veteran who served as a top-secret military intelligence non-commissioned officer. He went on to earn his marketing degree from SUNY Brockport, and now he's an entrepreneur, business investor, and Rochester City Councilman. His current podcast is titled Politically Correcting, and he aims to bridge the widening gap in the political world with that and in order to work towards a more perfect union. So again, a positive attitude. So I'd like to welcome now Jose Pio. So glad to have you here today.
Thank you so much. I appreciate the invite.
You're very welcome. And I know you've had quite a life journey, Jose, and now you're a city councilman. So and that's for the Northwest District, which is where I am. So I'm going to ask you to back it up a little bit, since you are from Rochester, and ask you, what's your childhood experience growing up in Rochester? What are your memories?
Yeah, my childhood was an absolute blessing, because I got to experience a complete diverse city. I was raised in the city for my adolescence, and then my parents were able to move us to West Aranacoit later on, and having that back and forth throughout, because my mom was working on the weekends, my dad was working every day, so we would go to my grandma's house and my uncle's house, me and my siblings, during the weekends. And my uncle and grandma lived on Conkey, Avenue D, Avenue C. You know, we lived on Hollenbeck, we lived in Strathmore Circle. We were all over the place in the Northeast. And having that diverse mentality of being raised in a city, but also living in the suburbs, and near the beach, near Somerville, going to Shalott Beach all the time. It was an amazing childhood, but at the same time, it instilled some values in me that that's lived with me for my life. My dad was very much a one of the believers that you will work and you will earn, you know, what you want. If you want those Nike sneakers, you're going to go find a job, or you're going to go mow some lawns or shovel some snow. And that's exactly what I did. The first amount of money that I got, it was from actually mowing some guy's lawn and cutting some bushes. First thing I bought was bought new Ken Griffey Jr. Nike sneakers, and I thought I was the man. I was so impressed, but it instilled in me that, you know, you earn what you get when you put in the work, and that's always live with me forever. So I really thank my dad for that.
That's wonderful. And I like that. It sounds very familiar to me. My dad was the same. We grew up on 4th Street near the public market, and you know, we had our chores, and one of them was to go up to the market every week and get, you know, the eggs and things like that, go to the meat man, the egg man. Well, they were all men back then, I guess, but.
Did you have brown eggs or were they white?
I think they were. I don't know. That's a good question.
Natural eggs are supposed to be brown, I guess.
Yeah, they probably were. I don't remember.
I haven't had a natural egg.
That's funny. But I have. My daughter had chickens for a while. And but anyways, that's another story for another day. But yeah, growing up in my dad used to say, you know, go over and mow that one's lawn and get the snow out of the path of, you know, Mrs. Burns down the street. And we always were like, well, why do we have to do it, Dad? And his answer was just do it. And one time I was on unemployment for a day, and I remember him saying, get up and get out and get a job. No one in this family is on unemployment.
Love it.
So, yeah, that's how I grew up, too. So it's nice to hear that. So our childhood experiences are familiar. What about how you got into politics? That definitely is unfamiliar to me. I'm wondering now if you'll tell the listeners, which part of the city are you covering, and how did you get into politics?
Yeah, so I cover the Northwest District. So I'm from Beach Avenue to 490 and from Lake Ave to Mount Reed. And what made me get into politics is the fact that I was tired of being a keyboard warrior. I was tired of talking about the change that I wanted. And I said, you know, let me get out there and do the work that's needed to get the future that I want for my child to grow up in.
Jose, I know that you have a lot to do with small businesses as well as being in politics. So tell the folks about your small business experience and what you do to help them.
Yes, I own TLS Funding Solutions. It's an alternative and flexible funding option for businesses out there that are not able to get through the underwriting or the conservative guidelines that banks offer. And it's actually, small business is my number two pillar for success. I truly believe that small business and owning one and getting into entrepreneurship is going to create a future for our city where our families who are living in poverty can then get out of poverty and no longer have to worry about employment or how much they're getting paid or how little they're getting paid, when they can worry about, you know, the value that they bring to the society around them and fixing the issues that they want to see. They can put it, you know, all upon themselves and have that personal responsibility and take that on to themselves and be able to make money off of it. It's a fantastic world we live in, or a country we live in, where we can do this.
Yes. And I know, you know, you're involved with the city, obviously. Are they also helping small businesses recover from COVID and all the things that we've been dealing with?
Yes, actually, we've invested about 2 to 3 times more in the Northwest and in businesses in the Northwest than in compared to the Northeast and Southwest districts. Businesses are wanting to come to the Northwest District to start and grow their businesses. And it's showing with the amount of investment that the city is giving in terms of grants and loans and tax breaks for businesses that are bringing not only the jobs, but also bringing in their revenue. And when you have jobs in the communities in which people live, the money stays there. And that's what we need.
And now you're saying that a lot of the money is going into this certain area in the Northwest District. Is that because those businesses have been affected more so than in the other areas?
No, that doesn't even include that. This is strictly for new businesses that are opening and starting or expanding in the Northwest. When it comes to businesses that were impacted by either COVID or, you know, unfortunately, there were some protests that ended in some, you know, destruction. Those were also monies that were given out from the city. And that's easily attainable. If you call 311, they can connect you with, if you're a business, call 311. They can connect you with the financing out there to help you to rebuild from the issues that you're facing from COVID or from any other issues that you're having. We can connect you with the right people who can teach you how to get into that next level of business.
Excellent. Now, I want to get in a positive vibe here because we got another minute or two. What are your thoughts on how to build Rochester into a destination location? Because I've heard that. I've heard that someday people are going to be coming here because other parts of the country are dealing with a lot of things.
Yeah, so it's going to start with the Northwest. We need to understand that the only way that we're going to be a destination city is if we invest in our beach area in Charlotte Beach, also invest in an international market on Lyle Avenue, because we need to be able to have an area where all people will want to come to Rochester, not just one group. We want all people to be able to come back to Rochester if they moved out or come visit us from, let's say, Canada.
Well, that's great because they're our neighbors. And when they open up that border, I'm going up there too because I miss my aunt and my cousin. I want to see them. But boy, there's a lot going on. And I guess I'm going to have to ask this question. Do you have any thoughts on how we stop the violence that we've been dealing with, Jose? We're talking to Jose P.O. here.
Yeah, absolutely. It comes down to opportunities, just providing opportunities for your young kids and for businesses to grow and for people to not turn to the streets. That just provide opportunities.
That's it. Thank you for your positivity and for being with us today, Jose. Please tell the folks how they can get a hold of you if they have any questions or would like to connect.
Very easy. Go to josepeo.com. That's josepeo.com. And you can go right on there and you can message me. Or, you know what? Feel free to follow me on Vote for PO on Facebook. You can follow me on social media.
And you also have a blog, right?
I've got my Politically Correcting podcast. So you can go to my Politically Correcting social media pages or search my podcast. It's available streaming on pretty much all platforms.
Terrific. Thank you so much for your work and thank you for your dedication to our city.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Jose. That was a great interview with him, and I appreciate what he does and his positivity, like I said in the interview. And we're going to have a great show today. We've got lots coming up. And after the break, we'll hear from Sarah LIPINSKI. She's with Genesee Valley Physical Therapy's Pittsford location, and she's going to talk to us about PT for older women. So if you're an older woman or you know one, keep listening to the Seniors Rock Show now on News Radio, Wham 1180, because we'll be right back.
Chuggin', got my chips cashed in. Keep chuggin', like the dude of man. Together, more or less in life.
Hi, we're back. Yeah, Mike's out there trucking around somewhere, but I'm here in the studio. I'm Joanna, your host, and I am happy to have you back with me and to introduce our next guest. It's Genesee Valley Physical Therapy's expert, Sarah LIPINSKI.
Hello, and thank you for having me on the show today, Joanna. So as you mentioned, my name is Sarah LIPINSKI, physical therapist with an interest in women's health. I'm also the director of Genesee Valley Physical Therapy in Pittsford, Bushnell's Basin area. At this location of Genesee Valley Physical Therapy, we offer general outpatient physical therapy services, but we also offer some different specialty services that really aren't quite as common for physical therapy clinics to have. These include vestibular rehab and women's health therapies. So women's health physical therapy includes an evaluation and treatment of a variety of different musculoskeletal conditions, such as pregnancy-related pain, both prenatal and postpartum, pelvic pain, and urinary incontinence, to name a few. So pregnancy, childbirth, chronic constipation, chronic coughing, surgery, trauma, and aging can cause pelvic floor muscle tension. It can also cause incoordination and weakness within the pelvic floor. On average, about 1 in 4 women have some symptoms from at least one pelvic floor dysfunction. And this can lead to urinary and or bowel incontinence, as well as pelvic pain. Additionally, urinary symptoms such as an increased frequency of going to the bathroom, increased urge to get to the bathroom, leaking or awakening at night to go to the bathroom are associated with an increased risk for falling within older adults. So there's some conservative treatment to help with pelvic floor muscle dysfunction, which includes what I do in physical therapy with pelvic floor physical therapy exercises that can improve the function of the pelvic floor. And these exercises are aimed at either strengthening the pelvic floor or relaxing the pelvic floor. And through patient education regarding techniques that can be used for bladder retraining at home. So if you would like any information regarding any of these services that we provide in Pittsford at Genesee Valley Physical Therapy, please don't hesitate. Please give me a call. I can be reached at 585-387-6000. 0430, or feel free to check out our website at www.GeneseeValleyPT.com. Thanks so much, Joanna, for having me on the show today.
Well, thank you, Sarah Lipinski, and thanks to Genesee Valley Physical Therapy for their work in all 7 of their locations and for sponsoring the Seniors Rock Show. We really appreciate it. We encourage listeners to support our sponsors because they're all carrying local companies. So please check out Genesee Valley Physical Therapy if you are looking for some help or just want to find out if you can get some. And speaking of sponsors, I'd like to remind you that Wise Home Energy gave us a heads up recently about money that's available for homeowners to help them make their home more energy efficient. That's right. New York State is offering a 50% match to dollars you spend to improve your house. So what's wrong with that? There's no obligation to see if you qualify. And then you've got 6 months to change your mind if you do apply and get approved and decide not to do it. Here's the catch. It's easy to apply, really easy, but deadline is looming. It's Tuesday, 8/31. That's 3 days away. So if you're interested in applying and getting this free money, there's no obligation to pay it back. If you're thinking about new heating, hot water, air sealing, insulation, anything like that that's going to improve the efficiency of your home, please call Wise Home Energy today and find out about this free money. It's based on your income guidelines, and that has been more lenient lately, I think maybe because of COVID, and they're helping families to save money and to get their houses more efficient. So again, a 50% match, no repayment needed if you qualify. Find out now. This program will no longer be available after the 8/31 deadline. That's this Tuesday. So go ahead and contact wisehomeenergy.com or call or text them at 585-270-5836. That's 270-5836 to see if you qualify. Don't forget, do it today. You've got 3 days. Jeff will help you. Jeff's our sponsor there, and you've heard him on the air, and he's got lots of good stuff for us. And hey, what's wrong with saving money, right? And speaking of sponsors, again, I wanted to say that I love co-hosting the Seniors Rock Show and balancing that with my retirement. And I also love that I can have more time to enjoy my retirement outside of the kitchen. And that's because I have effortlessly healthy meal delivery. You know, the kids are gone. I don't really need to spend 3 or 4 hours in the kitchen at night, you know, preparing, cooking, cleaning up, all that stuff. Not to mention the food we're not throwing out because it's just John and I now. And, you know, I tried to get things that we could make for 2 people, but I always ended up throwing food out. So, oh, there's a senior discount too. And so spending more money on food is not happening. We're actually down on the money we spent at the grocery store. So we pick our meals each week and dinner is ready in under 3 minutes. I love it. I recommend it. And I think you should go check out Effortlessly Healthy Foods today. Tell them you heard about it on the Seniors Rock Show, ehmeals.com. ehmeals.com is the email address, or I'm sorry, the website address. And you can go there anytime today or anytime to see if you can save some money. And they actually have, they have family plans and also dog food, if you can believe it. So check it out. And what else is going on today here? After the news, we're going to have Chris Gauvin. He's with Blossom Modern Home Care Solutions of Western New York. And you're probably like, well, what is that? And it actually used to be CCOR, so stay tuned for that. Chris has got some interesting information about what they're doing in home care. I think that they've spread out a little bit, too. So we'll talk about that, and we'll also talk about what's happening next weekend in the Finger Lakes. We've got some very interesting Native American things happening, if you stay tuned for that. And there's some rituals here in the Finger Lakes that are pretty cool. And that will be happening soon, too. So stay tuned for that. Wonder what you're doing today. I am happy that it's going to be a decent day. I think we're getting out of this heat. Pam, are you planning anything fun? Pam's our producer today.
I have a friend that just had a baby, so I'm going to be delivering her a baby gift this afternoon. And just kind of hanging out and enjoying the weekend. Nothing too crazy, though, other than that.
I thought you were going to say you were delivering the baby. I was like, wow, no. You really are. That's funny. Anyway, it's been fun working with you, Pam, and you're always right on. And Pam's in the background there. You know, she's doing a lot for us. And I just wanted to recognize you and Melanie, too, who comes in once in a while as well. And they stay over there and they're up in the tower downtown because we're still remote. But, you know, they're really important to the show. They're the ones that put it together for us. They're the ones that play the music. And I just wanted to say thank you to them because I'm thanking the sponsors. I'm thanking the listeners. And I hope that you'll come back every week. And in fact, next week is the holiday. So if you're out and about, you can take us with you. And you can put us on your phone, if you like, on the iHeartRadio app. It's free. And if it says, you know, you want the premium, just say no, it'll continue to be free. And you can listen to all kinds of stuff, radio, podcasts, that iHeartMedia or radio app is really, really awesome. I use it all the time. And you can just take your phone with you and have it like having a radio on you. And speaking of radio, we have been doing this for about a year now. I want to thank you for contacting us with information and telling us what you like. We just got an email this past week from someone who said they'd like to hear more about pets. And I know we all have those. I have two dogs. And I am going to look forward to having some folks on pretty soon to talk about pets. And we will also have some interesting things to share with you in the next couple of weeks about, well, I'm not going to tell you, it's a surprise. So we'll talk about that soon, but don't go away because we're going to break now, but we'll be right back with Chris Gauvin of Blossom Modern Home Care Solutions of Western New York on News Radio WHAM 1180 and the Seniors Rock Show.
Game. Shirley, bo burly, bo nana, banana, bo furly, be fine, mo merrily. Shirley.
Hi, and welcome back to the Seniors Rock Show. I am here now to introduce someone who knows about the name game because they just had a change. And his name is Chris Gauvin, the CEO of Blossom. And that is Modern Home Care Solutions of Western New York. But they were formerly CCOR, or Companion Care of Rochester. They're a licensed home care agency that provides a wide offering of home care services throughout Western New York. The company was started by Chris's dad back in 1998 in Rochester. So they now have offices in Batavia, Buffalo, and Geneva. So now I'll welcome Chris Gauvin to the show. Hi, Chris.
Hi, Joanna. Thanks for having me on. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely. Well, it's exciting news when a company like yours, you know, we're very familiar being part of the GRAPE organization, the Greater Rochester Area Partnership for the Elderly. I'm kind of privy to knowing when these things happen. And I know that you've been sharing it with our folks in the area. But tell us now about the name change, Chris. How did that happen and why did you do it?
Well, I think, you know, it's something we've kind of considered for a long time. I think you look at Companion Care of Rochester and, you know, we really don't provide as much companion services as we used to, and we're definitely have offices outside of Rochester and provide, you know, significant services outside of just this region. So the name, it didn't quite fit who we were and what we were doing. And I think, you know, but before you do anything like that, you want to make absolutely sure that where you're going and what you're doing, you put a lot of thought into, and, you know, you really kind of considered all the options. So our marketing team kind of led a project to look into rebranding and coming up with a new name. And I think that started probably about a year ago. So, you know, we asked all of our employees, got feedback from everyone in the company, as well as some key people that we provide services to, and just, you know, kind of slowly went down this path. And then, you know, last month we kind of released it to the world and put it out there. And, you know, I've been a part of these projects before, and I can't ever say that I've been more happy with what, you know, that team delivered for us to kind of really have a name that represents like who we are and what we do. So, you know, I don't know what you think of it. I'm absolutely in love with it. I think it looks really fresh. I think it's a really modern look for us. So I was very happy.
I like it too. The logo is very cool. And folks, you could check that out on their website, and Chris will tell us about that and, you know, where you can find it in a few minutes here. And yes, it took a year to do that. Isn't that interesting? Because it's important. The name of a company is super important and it tells what you do. And Modern Home Care Solutions says a lot. Tell us about the types of things that you're getting, you know, requests for now. You said that some of the services have changed. What are the new supporter services that you're offering?
Well, I think you know, as we've grown as a company, you know, like I said, we started off as a companion agency, and then we moved into providing licensed services, more hands-on care and services like that. And as we did that, you know, I always kind of had a vision to have the company be a place where people could go and get as many different services as they possibly could. So, you know, we went into becoming a fiscal intermediary and providing consumer-directed services. We also did service coordination for a long time, but unfortunately, we're not able to provide that anymore. But because of that social work piece that we brought in, we started to get into health homes as well, which if your listeners are not familiar with, it's more of a newer program, but it continues to grow significantly inside of our organization and provides for people on Medicaid a good social work stopgap to kind of assist them with getting services and finding services and those kind of things. But you know, we're constantly evaluating what kind of things we can do in the home and what kind of services we can provide in our consumers' homes. You know, just to provide as many different services as we can. As you know, with COVID over the last year and a half and everything we've all kind of gone through here, you know, we've been really hyper focused on the services we can provide and what we can do, and just trying to do the best job we can with that for sure.
Give us some examples, Chris, of the services. I know, you know, folks are wondering what can you do when you go into a home, because sometimes you hear different things. I've heard, you know, well, these people can't really do anything like touch you, you know, comb your hair. Mm-hmm. But I know that there's so many different levels of care. So do you take all of that into consideration? It depends on the person's needs, obviously. But I mean, I think you do everything mm-hmm. from helping them feed their pets to taking them shopping. I mean, is that all included?
The pet thing can get a little interesting. For most of the services that we provide are very centered on the actual person that we're taking care of, and not necessarily, you know, family members or pets or those kind of things.
Pets are very important to people, especially, you know, when you get older and they're kind of like your family. So if you're there to help, you know, doing other things with the client, I think it's great that you can help them to make sure that the animals are getting taken care of too.
Sure. you know, we can do everything from providing meals to home cleanup to, like you said, to doing transport, to assisting with bathing, showering, toileting, those kind of things. You know, the point where it gets a little challenging for us is in medications. We can't do a whole lot with it, administering of medications. We can do reminders and those kind of things. But for the most part, you know, the services we can provide are very helpful to keep people safe in their home. And you know, we service everyone. We service is on a wide spectrum. We have people that are, you know, completely bedbound that we take care of. And we have other people that you wouldn't even know that they needed services. They only need a couple hours a week, you know, us to come in and basically assist with a couple few small little things. So, you know, mm-hmm. it really depends on the person and what their needs are.
Yes. And thank you. Because, you know, I mean, you and I being, you know, in this organization of GRAPE and being familiar with the services out there, you know, folks sometimes don't understand or don't know before it happens to them and they need it. So I like that you're helping to educate our families out there. And if they're wondering what happens, you know, when you get to the point where you need some help in the home, what kinds of things you can do. So I think that's very helpful. And I love what your organization does. And I want to know now, what areas do you service? It sounds like you've been growing. Your dad must be very proud.
Definitely. So we've got offices in Buffalo, Batavia, and Geneva, as well as Rochester. And we pretty much service everything around those offices. So, you know, we go pretty much from Geneva all the way west out to Buffalo would be the area that we service. You know, Wayne County, Ontario County, Erie County, Monroe County, of course, are some of our primary service areas that we provide care in.
Excellent. Now, let's talk about the GRAPE organization, because I met you through GRAPE. And folks, if you don't know what that is, it's the Greater Rochester Area Partnership for the elderly, I'm sorry. And Chris and now called Blossom Modern Home Care Solutions of Western New York are part of that, as well as probably close to 300 other people that work out in the, you know, in the area and in the community, helping families and elders. Tell us a little bit about how you got involved in that. I know you do a lot to support our combined efforts, Chris, and I thank you for that. But how do you feel about GRAPE?
Well, how much time do you have? Because I could talk about this for a while.
Well, and you got 2 minutes.
You know, when you Okay, cool. When you brought it up earlier, you know, asking me about the specific services we provide, I think one of the great things about Grape is that there's a lot of different organizations in there that we become very familiar with. And it's almost like a family of companies that if we can't do something, we know somebody who can. And I know services are very complicated. And like I said earlier, everybody has their specific needs. So for me, when I first came into the organization, I think it was 12 years ago, my father had joined Grape a number of years before that, I think at least 3 or 4 years before that. It gave me a great opportunity to start to learn and connect with all these other great companies in the Rochester area that do things that we don't do. And then we could work together to really find a complete package solution for people. So I personally have been very active in it, less active over the last couple of years because of how busy everything for me has been. But our organization continues to be incredibly active. I know Marie Candelora is currently the president of the organization, and so she's very actively involved and is a huge advocate for that, for Grape as well. And I think if I were to look back on everything I've ever done in this job, my favorite part has been working with Grape, working with all those other companies on just getting these solutions and solving these problems for our senior community. I mean, I love it.
I can hear the passion in your voice, and that's what got me hooked too. So folks, if you want to know more about Grape, you can go to the Greater Rochester Area Partnership for the Elderly on their website and find out about it. But today, Chris, thank you so much for sharing with us about your changes and about Blossom Modern Home Care Solutions of Western New York, formerly CCOR, and I'll be learning more about it, I'm sure, this year as we start to do our meetings in September. Grape is a great organization, and I have learned so much too, and learned about you and your organization. So thank you for bringing that up and showing your passion, because I think everybody in that group is passionate.
Absolutely, Joanna, anytime.
Thank you so much. We'll have you back again, and good luck with the growth, and have a great Saturday.
Yep, you enjoy your day too.
Thanks, Chris. Well, hello, and I'm Joanna, your host. You're listening to the Seniors Rock Show, and we're here every Saturday from noon till 1. That song was the Iroquois Friendship Song. We played it today because, you know, we have a very rich history of Native American culture here in the Finger Lakes and the upstate New York area. And again this year, we wanted to remind you that the Seneca Nation Festival of Lights, the Ring of Fire tradition, will light up the lakes literally beginning at 9 o'clock on the Saturday of Labor Day weekend. So that signals the end of summer. Oh, boo. But the tradition holds a deeper meaning, too. So I'll tell you about it. The celebration stems from the Seneca ritual of giving thanks to Mother Earth for her bounty and sharing in that gratitude across the lakes. On Canandaigua Lake, for example, the Ring of Fire will coincide with the lighting of the bonfire on top of Bear Hill over the east side of the lake in the Yates County town of Middlesex. The bonfire is accompanied by a ceremony celebrating Seneca culture, and that's based for many centuries in the Middlesex area. We've got, as I said, a rich history. So we're glad to hear that they're doing something new this year. They're using, it started a couple years ago, but it's getting really popular, reusable chemical-free LED flares. They're being used now, and there's many lake protection groups in the region, and they've pledged to convert to LEDs, and that's because they're more environmentally safe. So thank you for that. And I'm laughing here because, you know, we're remote, so we're looking at each other on the screen here, but Pam, it does a great job, and so do the folks in this area when it comes to celebrating our heritage and the folks that were here before us, the Seneca Nation. I'm going to try to say this, Ganondagagan, I think that's how you say it, State Historic Site Manager Peter Jemison is going to be celebrated this year at the Seneca Nation Festival of Lights over by Canandaigua Lake. And it's very interesting, and I've met this man, and he's so fascinating. And he's actually a direct descendant of Mary Jemison. And if you don't know who she was captured at age 12 during the French and Indian War in 1755. And she became, you know, fell in love with their culture and stayed with them on her own. And so Peter Jemison, that's one of his ancestors. I think that's really neat. And you can meet him out there at that historic site. And they have a museum now, and they have a longhouse that's really fascinating. So I recommend that you go to Ganondagagan State Historic Site if you haven't been there, and celebrate that culture as well as our own, because they were here and they're still here, and we don't ever want to forget that. So we've been talking a little bit about history now, and I'm going to go forward and we're going to talk about the future. I guess it's not even the future, it's current. And I was fascinated with this too. And if you haven't heard about robots and some of these lifelike robots, I want you to meet Grace. And she's a ultra lifelike nurse robot. And she's coming from Hanson Robotics, and that's a company in Hong Kong that has been doing this for a while, but they just unveiled their latest invention, and it's Grace. And the reason I'm bringing that up is she's a humanoid robot that helps, that they hope will revolutionize healthcare. And she's designed as an assistant for doctors. She's equipped with sensors, like including a thermal camera, so she can detect patients' temperatures and pulse, that kind of thing. And she can actually help doctors diagnose illness and deliver treatments. So isn't that nuts? It's really crazy that this stuff is happening. They're actually using them now in hospitals. In Shanghai, for example, they employ more than 50 robots to help care for patients. And the Android is a companion for patients too, not just for the doctors. And I guess they're really specializing in senior care, which is why I'm bringing it up. And Grace can speak in three languages, English, Mandarin, and Cantonese. And she can socialize and conduct talk therapy. How about that? I'm assuming music therapy is just around the corner. But I just thought that that was so fascinating, and I wanted to share that with folks. If you want to read more about it, you can go to our Facebook page, Seniors Rock Radio, and you know, I'll connect you there with it. And there's a picture of Grace, and it's amazing. She looks just like a real person. Pam, you got to check it out. And do we have a caller? Okay, Jim's on the phone. Hello, Jim.
How are you guys doing?
Hi.
I'd like to just make a quick comment. Going back, I would say good at least 30 years ago, if you researched on the computer, Dr. Peter Beter, he gave a lot of information out about organic robotoids back then.
Wow, so it's not as new as I thought, huh?
Yes, very interesting. The Russians have been doing it since then. We've been doing it since then.
Are you involved in the robotics?
No. I just remember doing some reading and research on the subject, and we're going back at least 30, 40 years ago. There was a basically an organic. They were called organic robotoids.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, the stuff that they're doing, and they're actually in use now.
Right. Yeah, but we were doing it for a lot longer than, I mean, it's just coming out in the public eye right now.
Well, I'm glad that we could be helpful in that area, because I think we're telling people that probably I didn't know about it, and hopefully some of our listeners are learning about it now too, because we do need help in the area. We need a lot of geriatric help, and you know, so I'll take it if we can get some assistance from robots. Why not, right?
Right, sure. And,
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Jim.
Yeah, look up Dr. Peter Beter. You know, he has passed. Probably 10, 15 years ago, but he's got a lot of very good tapes about the organic robotoids and what they were used for, how we used them against what's the Russians, It was a very interesting reading.
Well, thank you for calling, and thank you for sharing that with us, because it is interesting. I mean, it's been a long time that it's, you know, happening in the world, I guess, and we're just starting to get up to speed and learning more about it. So thanks, Jim, for calling. I think we have Steve on the line, And I'm right here, Steve. What's up?
Good morning, Joanna. Yeah, Joanna.
Yes.
I think you had mentioned in the beginning of your broadcast that you're originally from 4th Street in the city.
That's correct.
Ah, yeah. So was I. Long time ago, I lived right near 4th and Hayward.
Oh, I live between Garson and Hayward.
I see. Well, you were probably like right down the street. Our old house is actually no longer there as of like 10 years ago. I think it burned down.
Wow. Yeah, it's different now, but boy, I remember those days. We probably played down at that corner lot. I think there's an apartment building there now, but I remember all the kids in the neighborhood going down there and playing ball and that kind of stuff. What do you can you share your age, Steve?
Sure. I'm 71. And
I'm 60. I will be 68. I keep saying I'm 68. I'm actually only 67, but I will be. So, yeah. So we were there around the same time. That's crazy.
Yeah. I was. I arrived on the planet in 49. So
53.
But I moved out when I was 60. I went to live with my brother and his wife in Irondequoit. Yeah, I moved out at 60 at age 11.
I'm so glad you're listening to the show, Steve, and I'm so glad that you called to share that with us and my neighborhood. And it's always great to have memories. And folks, I hope you'll join us next week on the Saturday noon till 1 Seniors Rock Show for more memories. And I hope you have a wonderful holiday as well, because the long weekend's coming up. Pam, thanks for your help today. Everybody, Mike's off, but he always reminds us to enjoy your week and tells us to be well and be kind. And I hope you're enjoying your day and that you remember always that seniors rock.